WFYL, this is Russ.
Russ, I'm going to be out of the area this weekend, and I still want to hear your station. Can you help me out?
I sure can. In fact, you can listen absolutely anywhere you go and anytime. Go to our website, 1180WFYL.com, on your favorite mobile device. That's 1180WFYL.com. And click listen live.
That's all it takes?
That's all it takes. Also, if you are in the car, I would advise you not to look at your phone. The best solution I can recommend is the TuneIn app, available on the Apple and Android app stores for free. TuneIn has a car mode in order to make listening and driving safer. Keep in mind that this will use your mobile data, which could result in extra charges from your mobile provider. Be sure to check your plan before using the stream.
That sounds great, Russ. Thank you so much for your help.
Thank you for calling in for listening. Drive safe and God bless.
This is Mark Hopkins, back with another episode of Unsung. Today we're interviewing Cecily Tynan from Channel 6. She's the head meteorologist.
Chief meteorologist.
Chief.
Same thing.
Chief. Well known to many people, but I don't know so many by her voice. We've been going back and forth trying to get an interview, and we've been
finally, it took a few months to get our schedules.
I really appreciate your time.
Oh, I'm glad to be able to do this.
Right before you go on the news, and she's dressed to go on the news and be in front of everybody.
I do.
And I'm dressed to work on her house.
Full makeup. And well, I come into work with wet hair and sweats and no makeup. So
see, I don't think anybody would even recognize you, so it's a disguise.
That's how I do most of my life. Go around grocery shopping and everything.
How did you get started in this business?
You know, I got started back in, well, I guess it was in high school when I was watching the Space Challenger disaster. I remember going back and watching Dan Rather telling the world about this. And then I thought, wow, communications, that what he's doing right now is so important. So I knew I wanted to get in the field of communications. And I went to Washington Lee University in Lexington, Virginia. I double majored in politics and journalism. And I interned at CNN. I interned at WDBJ in Roanoke. And when I was a senior, I'm sorry.
We can't stop the news.
We may have to hear that occasionally. So when I was a senior, they hired me as a weekend reporter. And so I did that even after I graduated. I actually had a job in TV, which most people who graduated from school aren't quite as lucky. It was only part-time, so I worked all these other jobs. And then their weekend weathercaster position opened. And I tried out for it. I got it. And I realized this is the part of the newscast that's most important to most people, that this is the only part of the newscast everybody wants to hear. And
right.
And then I realized, I wish I went to school for meteorology. So then I started taking classes in meteorology to get my CEAL. And that took about 8 years. It would have been easier if I just had a four-year college. And so I went out to Las Vegas to the ABC affiliate out there, KTNV. I was a morning meteorologist and anchor. And then I reported. And then out of the blue, after about 2 years there, I got a phone call from the news director here at WPVI. And they were looking for their first weekend meteorologist. Up until then, Rob Jennings read the 5-day forecast we had back then. And it's funny because he tells a story that when they hired him, he said, will I get a weekend meteorologist? And they said, sure. It took them 18 years. And he said they had to wait for me to grow up.
18 years.
So 18 years he waited. And then, as soon as I came here for my interview, I knew this was home. And it was 22 years ago.
My father used to say that they put the weather at the end of the news in toto, the same reason that the milk and eggs are always the other end of the
it's
store.
True.
Make you go through
it's
it.
True. It's to make you wait. Exactly.
They put it the first, most people would turn off.
Yeah.
And someone hang on for sports.
No, it's true. Sometimes we'll give a little, you know, snippet in the beginning, but yeah, we save weather for the end.
What was the first thing you remember learning here, actually doing the job?
The first, actually, learning how to pronounce Skugel and Conshohocken was one thing, because when I first got here, Dave Frankel was our morning weathercaster and he was going on vacation. So I was here for, I think, 1 or 2 days, and they put me on the morning show and the noon show, and we had all the Sky Sixes, and I'm from the East Coast, but I'm from Connecticut. I was born and raised in Newtown, Connecticut. So I really wasn't familiar with the Philadelphia area. So, and you don't want to mispronounce Conshohocken or Skugel.
People get right on the phone.
Oh,
right,
they away. Will. They will.
And you can hear that every day to this day. It's gotten better, but you can hear when a set the bus stops and pronounces names wrong. And
it
just still irritates me. Who mentored you when you started?
Robin Reed at WDBJ in Roanoke, Virginia, and he was the chief meteorologist there, and he is now their main anchor, and we're still in touch on Twitter and texting each other back and forth, and he really taught me how to remain calm when there's a big storm, and he said, you know, sometimes you have to just wait and take a breath, and you don't want to freak people out because they are going to the news for reassurance and for information. And if you're panicking, they're panicking. And so Robin Reed really was my mentor. And here I have to say Jim Gardner, just for presence on the news and the fact that everything he does is not for him, it's for the viewer. And so I want to follow in his footsteps, and I try to do the same thing.
Yeah, I always say he's like our Cronkite.
Yeah, he really is.
He's a rock.
Really, and he's told me, and very intimidating when you first meet him, and then you get to know him, and he's got a great sense of humor, and he's self-effacing, and he's very private. And once he said something wrong on the air, and later I said, I didn't want to correct you. And he said, by all means, correct me. I don't want to say, if I say something wrong, correct me, because I don't want to give the public bad information.
I saw a clip that I shared with my assistant chief, because he's kind of the same way when he gets stuck on something. And you could have superimposed the two over each other.
Uh-huh.
You had lost a contact lens.
Oh, no, it was my earring.
The earring.
Oh, yes.
And he could not get it out of his mind. And he just, like a eagle swooping down on his
prey. It's so funny. That video went viral. They had Kelly and Ryan, Kelly Ripa had that on the air the next day. And it was just so funny. And then the funny thing is when I saw this massive white behind me, and I thought, wait, is there something wrong with the graphics? I thought it was a cloud. And then I realized it was Jim's hair. And he gave it to me, and then I had to finish my forecast. But
he was like a hawk on it.
He was
great.
And I think he really freaked out our producers because he had to take his microphone off. He's like, uh-oh, Jim's on the run now. What's happening?
He's going rogue.
Yeah.
What's the best part of the job?
My coworkers, definitely. I mean, it really, like, it's so cliche, but we are a family here. And I love my coworkers. And I also love the viewers. I mean, I love the fact that people will tell you right away if they're happy with you, if you're not, you know,
No,
and I like that. And I think that's the East Coast mentality, that I'd rather you tell me to my face than say something to my face and lie behind my back. So I love that.
Right. What's the hardest part of the job?
Probably dealing with backlash when the forecast doesn't pan out as expected, especially with winter storms. Especially now that we have social media. It used to be that people would just write you a hate letter. But now they can tell you right away
on
your Facebook page.
Everywhere.
Exactly.
Yeah.
There are, you know, I have to say, dealing with trolls is the worst part of my job. But I got a thick skin. And it's funny because you can have thousands of positive comments. That one negative one is the one that gets you.
Yeah.
And my husband will say, just ignore it. And it's hard to.
It's like if you're looking at a Amazon review, you gravitate towards the negative
ones. Exactly.
I started the negative ones to see what's the worst, and then I read the positive ones.
But if that's the worst thing about my job, I have a great job, and I really think I do.
Yeah, I just don't like – I think during the weather, you're a target automatically. Because,
oh, you are. Yeah, it's an old joke.
And,
I wish I, you know, could get paid for being wrong 90% of the time. And it's like, you know, actually, we're right about 99% of the time if we could keep track.
Do you think the weather's more – predictable, changing faster? Seems to be changing faster.
You know, I think as far, I mean, we've had amazing advances in technology and, you know, with our satellites and our radars and that, and now we here at Action News, we do a 7-day forecast. And I think that it's more predictable, but I also feel like I do believe in climate change and global warming. And I think that we are getting more intense storms and we are getting some bigger fluctuations
in the weather. So we can predict them, but they're happening faster too.
We can see with the hurricanes this season is that with the warm ocean, they just explode. And we have amazing computer models to use for forecasting. And a lot of times they can't grasp the intensity. A lot of our hurricanes this summer, they intensified so much faster than expected, and I think it's just because the world's climate is changing.
Do you think this is going to be more commonplace as things go on?
I think that we will have cycles, but I do think that we're going to see more intense storms as we head through the years, and more intense droughts and more intense floods.
Am I going crazy, or is fall is my favorite time of year? Is fall just becoming like this this 2-week period?
So yeah, it's sometimes it seems like we head straight from summer to winter. Well, you know, I've used this analogy on the air that the change of seasons is like toppling over a fridge. It's got to rock back and forth a few times before you can get it to swing over.
Okay.
So we're going through right now, even, you know, this past week where we have a couple of days where below normal. And then all of a sudden, you know, 2 days later, we're in the mid 80s.
Yeah.
But then we'll go back. So it's just, and actually we do have a nice string of some nice, like, seasonable weather coming our way.
The weather's an easy target for people. Do you think that, you said trolls give you a problem online, and do you think more people are out there thinking they're experts because they're looking at stuff online, and it's more to it than that, like any job?
Well, there is. I mean, there's a lot of information online, and
it's an experience.
I mean, you can look. You could go on your computer and you could look up the GFS or the Euro model, but they're just a guide, and you really do have to, sorry about that. You really do have to, you know, based on experience, know that, you know, there's some of these models do have a certain bias, or I've had experience with warm fronts in the years where they don't move out as quickly as you think. And in the winter where there's a boundary layer as far as freezing rain, and in the past we've think, oh, the temperatures are just going to be high enough that we won't get freezing rain. But then we do. They drop just a little bit at the surface. So, you know, it's one of these things where you're predicting the future, and it's never easy, but you do learn from when the forecast goes right and from when it goes wrong.
What do you think makes you good at your job?
I think I'm honest, and I think that I'll try to convey uncertainties with a forecast. And I also think I don't take myself too seriously. I mean, I will. My husband says I'm an Indian blanket because every time I'm on the air, I make at least one mistake or flub. But it's live TV, and I don't rehearse what I'm saying. I don't write it down. You know, it's off the cuff. I do research, but sometimes I think you just sometimes people take themselves too seriously. It really is, and I really love my job too.
Well, and that's going to give me a segue into the king of weather and not being serious, Jim O'Brien.
Jim O'Brien.
His pictures him
he was amazing. And the one regret I have in my career is I didn't have a chance to work with him. And a lot of people here have. And I've heard amazing stories and I've seen video. And talk about, yeah, somebody who made weather fun, you know?
It'd be really fun to see him and Jim
Gardner,
having grown old together, to see the clowning around, because he was at the beginning and they were both young at that point.
But I wish I had a chance to work with him.
He was great. The We're sitting in a giant room. It's full of computers used to predict the weather, and I see you probably do broadcasts and stuff. I think I've seen some.
We do. We have that camera that we can do hits if we have, say, like a tornado warning or something that we don't have. The studio's on the other side of the building, and so sometimes if we do have violent weather, we can do cut-ins right from here.
And you go outside sometimes to do it.
Yeah. And that's leftover from Dave Roberts.
Yeah.
So we still do that. Actually, there's a picture over there of Dave Roberts with the clouds that when I came here, we used the magnetic clouds.
Yeah.
And I still have... I-